Well, welcome back to Keys of the Kingdom. We were talking about, are Christians idiots? Are they fooled? Are they deceived? We know that a strong delusion is coming, and we know that many people would be deceived, even the very elect. A lot of people think that deception has not got here yet. I think it's been here for quite some time. It began immediately at the Pentecost, where people began to try to distort the truth. It was ongoing even before that. It has been with us since the garden. And the idea that you can decide what is good and evil by your intellectual ability to calculate what the truth is the basis of that strong delusion. You can't. The only way you will know the truth is by the divine inspiration of the Holy Spirit in your hearts and in your minds. That's the only way you can really know it. Now, we have gifts like the Bible, and we have prophets that come about from time to time and will reveal to us, and God sends us little messengers from time to time. But these are ways in which we can check whether or not what we're listening to is really the Holy Spirit. And an awful lot of ministers are not listening to the Holy Spirit because they have done things that are absolutely clearly, without question, in contradiction to what Jesus said to do. They are in contradiction to what Moses said to do, what God said to do. And the results of that is that they've begun, gone back and become entangled again in the bondage of the world, in the elements of the world. And we have a study on that too, as well, is that this, what are the elements of the world? Is it, are you entangled again in the atomic structure of the world? Because that's not what those words really mean. It has to do with this system of things, where you have become a thing and you become entangled. You go back into the bondage of Egypt, back into the bondage of the world, same thing. And that's where everybody is today. And the forefront leaders that have brought the people into this bondage are the apostate church ministers of the world. And they are ministers of the world, and not ministers of Jesus Christ. They are not a part of the body of Jesus Christ. They had some belief, but they have some unbelief, and unfortunately, they have been deceived and led off. Now, they may be good men. Now is their time to repent, because now we're going to reveal some truths. The Bible talks about baptism. The baptism of John the Baptist, the baptism of Jesus Christ. Anybody who received the baptism of Jesus Christ was cast out of the welfare system operated by the Pharisees in the temple. We know that from John's writings about the blind man and his parents, that they would not be a part of that system anymore. And if you don't know the history of how that system works, you know, that's why we wrote the book Thy Kingdom Come and all these articles on it. The reality was is that Herod started a system of social welfare, and it was building it on a pre-existing system that had been established by the Hasmoneans, but and this Sanhedrin, which was their Congress of the day. And in 78 B.C., this took a big jump. But Herod ended up baptizing, sending up ministers all over the known world and baptizing people into the kingdom of heaven. When they were baptized, their names were written down in books by scribes, which means accounters or accountants. And they would write their names down. And these ministers would go out and baptize people and write their names down, give them a new Hebrew name. They'd give them a little white stone with that Hebrew name carved on it and a couple of letters, usually about three letters. And they would use that stone and their own words out of their own mouth, held in their hand, to say, yeah, I'm a member of that system. And they would show that little stone, and that would be their marker identity. And they would say, okay, so-and-so, he's here on such and such a day, and he needs this benefit, and he's entitled to it according to our books. And so, therefore, he gets this benefit. But he also may have to pay in according to statutory regulations. And these were the benefactors who exercised authority. Herod's benefactors who exercised authority. They compelled the contributions of the people, small little amount at the beginning, and money flowed in, so much so that he could build this huge temple, this golden temple. And they had the gold, that's kind of their backup reserve fund. They also had a treasury, a royal treasury, that Jesus is seen in the royal treasury, according to the Greek text, instructing the ministers. How come he's in there? He's the king. He's in that royal treasury instructing the ministry. He sits on the left side and watches the contributions coming in. And he says, who gave more? The rich man who gave half, 50%, or the widow who gave all she had? You know, what? He's looking for righteousness. He ends up giving a command that nobody can carry vessels anymore in the temple. How can he give that command? He's the king. I'm just astounded that Christians don't know he's the king. He's heralded as the king when he comes into Jerusalem. He's going into the royal treasury, the gastophone, explaining to the ministers how to operate. This is ticking a bunch of them off, because at that time the ministers were living in opulence even greater than that of those who worked directly for Herod. And what's going on? What's going on is that he's the king. And he fires the money changers, something only the king could do, and could do since the days of David. So what is the difference between his kingdom and Herod's kingdom? Herod compelled the contributions. We were instructed we could not compel the contributions that took care of the needy of our society. How is our society bound together? They're bound together by love only. It doesn't, this has nothing to do with being organized or not organized. It has to do with, is your organization, the root of your organization, love for one another, or is the root of your organization a desire to control and regulate one another? You go into a lot of these churches. I had a minister in North Carolina talking to me about this. I've had a lot of ministers over the year talking to me, where they're under another minister, and he is just telling them what to do left and right. Even to the point of telling people in their congregation who they can marry and who they can't marry. Now, you can advise, but you can't boss. You can't dictate. You can't regulate, because you're in the kingdom of God. You're giving people the right to choose. Now, you have rights to choose. A minister doesn't have to marry a couple. If he thinks that this marriage is ill-conceived, or there's somebody's not being honest, or somebody needs to do some more rethinking about it, and he just doesn't feel right about it, he has the right. He isn't a slave to them. He's a slave to Christ. And Christ tells him what to do through the Holy Spirit in his conscience. And, you know, and we see the evidence of that or not. And if we see him marrying Steve and Mike, we say, well, I don't go along with that. He's not my minister anymore. I'm not going to pay any more tithing to that minister. The problem is, that's not the minister you tie it to. The minister you tie it to is the judge down there in the state of New York or the state of whatever. And he's going to marry Mike and Steve. And he's going to decide whether or not your children should be raised according to your values, because they ain't your children. They belong to the state. I mean, who takes care of them? Whose table do they eat at? They don't eat at your table. They eat at the state's table. Why? Because you eat at the state's table. You pray to the benefactors who exercise authority. You make covenants with them. You make applications. You write out an application. You sign it under penalty of perjury. Why do you do all this? Because your preacher said it's okay. But God said, don't make these agreements. Don't be like them. It is not to be that way with you. John the Baptist was offering the people a system based on its beginning was based in this moment of baptism whereby you took care of one another through faith, hope, and charity. They asked him right out, why? How are you doing these things this way? And he says, and explaining how it worked, he said, if your neighbor doesn't have a coat, you got to share. Faith, hope, and charity. That's not the way Herod was doing it. They called them both the kingdom of God. And today we have things called the church. And they say, oh, we're the church. How do you take care of your widows and orphans and needy of your society? I mean, because that's what pure religion is how you do that. And pure religion does that unspotted by the world. And the world, the word world there is constitutional order or system of government. The church today does not take care of its widows and orphans and needy of its society unspotted from the world. So therefore, that church today is not pure religion. And it's not pure religion because it's not pure belief. It is dirty belief. It is gutter religion. It is false belief. It is antichrist. Because it's not teaching the people to live by faith, hope, and charity. And the only way you can do that is to get organized from the bottom up, not from the top down. Pick your minister and only give him what you want to give freely. And then watch him to make sure he does what's right with it. So, before we run out of program, I know a lot of you are waiting to find out what it does mean to say that they were unlearned and ignorant. Because they weren't unlearned and ignorant. With all the background that I've given you, this will be a little bit of a surprise. The normal word for ignorant that you find in the Bible is not either one of those words. And I'm talking about the New Testament Greek. The word that is normally translated ignorant or unlearned is A-G-N-O-E-O. And none of those words are what we see in Acts 4:13. What we see there is two words. One is idiotis, which actually means a private person, not involved in public affairs, not a public person, a private person. Eventually that became used by the Romans in idiota. They said, well, they're an idiot because they're not joining our social welfare system through the pagan temples, like the Temple of Saturn, which was really the Bureau of Vital Statistics for Rome. That's where your birth registration was put. Why birth registrations? To know when you're entitled to benefits. Because you get benefits at different ages, and it tells you who your parents are, and they're a part of the Pax Romana, because the emperor is the patronus, the father. And whenever you applied for a benefit, it was our Father who art in Rome. Hallowed be thy name. Give us our daily bread. And they got it. But that father in Rome exercised authority, did not live by faith, hope, and charity. And that changed the people of Rome and set them up for when the unrighteous mammon fails. It did not allow the Holy Spirit to enter into people who were coveting their neighbor's goods, because the Holy Spirit won't do that. The Christians were saying, our Father who art in heaven, give us our daily bread. Well, where did their daily bread come? Show you right in meetings in the first century after Christ. They gathered, and those that had shared with those that didn't have. With loaves of bread, not little wafers. Loaves of bread was the Eucharist of Christ. To sustain the people when there was true need. And it's cheaper, quicker, faster, better. Amongst men who really love their neighbor as themselves. So this other word that we see there in that text as unlearned is A-G-R-A-M-M-A-T-O-I. And it comes from a word that means to write. So that means they couldn't write. I have looked all over and text after text after text trying to find out how that word was used in other Greek texts. It only appears once in the Bible. And the only place I found it was in relationship to muster rolls of a battalion or the registry of members. And what they were saying there is these men were not a member of the Social Security system set out by Herod, by the baptism of Herod. They were unregistered in that system. They were private persons, separate from that. They couldn't get any of those benefits, but they didn't have to pay in. They had opted out of the Social Security system offered by Herod. Why? Because Christ preached that that system made the word of God to none effect. It was the system of Corbin. The sacrifices of the people were compelled by their membership in a social welfare system that took care of the needy of their society, from the blind to the old age to whatever, to the crippled. If you return to the ways of Christ, the ways of Abraham, the ways of Moses, will you start taking care of one another through faith, hope, and charity, you will see miraculous healings of people that will stick. And you do not have to rob energy away from your neighbor to do that. I have seen healers gathering together. They love to do this in an emotional setting. Get a very emotional crowd together, because that emotion feeds their belief in the orchestrator of the events. And you will see these people all gathering around to be healed. The next day, or that day even, you will see some of them healed. Where did they get the energy from to do that? From the Holy Spirit? Or did they get it from this emotional circus that they've created, where they drew this energy out of this person and that person and that person, who just feel the outpouring? You know cutters? You know what cutters are? People who cut themselves and make themselves bleed. They've seen a real beautiful young girl, arms just sliced. She'd been cutting herself because the flowing of life out of her gave her a sense and feeling of life. And there are people that have that, and they are subject to vampires who suck the life out of them, the spiritual life out of them, because they get them in these emotional settings where they get them all worked up. And they will run up to give their emotional energy away, their spiritual energy away. You all have the power to heal. But unfortunately, if it is not tempered with the power of the Holy Spirit and the character of the Holy Spirit, you will also impart your diseases to other people, and not just the healing, but the poison as well. And this is what often happens in these emotional gatherings, where everybody gets and they think it's the Holy Spirit. Well, it's spirit. It may not be the Holy Spirit. Jesus didn't have to go get people worked up in order to heal the woman who just touched his garment. Her belief saved her. But belief in what? You can believe in lots of things and it may heal you. The placebo effect. But is that healing coming from the character of God, the character of life, the source of life, the tree of life? You can believe in all kinds of things and it will give you power. But is it the Holy Spirit of God, the creator of the universe? the creator of life. And there are ways to see whether it is or not. We are all deceived daily. We need to be careful of that. So all these guys were noting and taking knowledge of is that these were unregistered private people. But we can't have them translating it like that. And not that the King James guys were screwing up. They went to school. They were products of the church before them. They were around 500 years after the Inquisitions, where they killed out everybody who might actually know and believe in the gospel of the kingdom. And then they controlled the education. They controlled our understanding of Greek. That's why you got Thayers going back and trying to figure out what the Greek really meant. And he changed his opinion over the years, even after he wrote his Thayers. And I had a minister say, oh, well, it's not what you think this word means, like in the case of Romans 13. Minister wanted to say, no, I always use theirs. I rely on theirs. I says, well, let's open up theirs. Definition. The liberty of choice. So if we're going to go by theirs, that's what it means. You want to go by Strong's? That's what it means. You want to go by ancient Greek texts? That's what it means. You want to go by people speaking Koine? That's what it means. They say, oh, you have to look at it in the context of the whole. How is it used most of the time in the Bible? Read the book Higher Liberty. And you'll see how it's used most of the time in the Bible. It's talking about the government of Jesus. Your right to choose. God gave you that right to choose. Now, are you choosing life or are you choosing to take life from others? This, you know, the tax situations in the world governments today is evidence of the fact that we have already turned our back on God. The choice of Saul is evidence of the fact that we have already turned our back on God. Our present circumstances and condition is evidence of the fact that we have not been striving and seeking the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Now, if we're doing that, we're going to see two things. We're going to love the ways of God, which are the ways of faith, hope, and charity, not force, fear, and violence. Because no Levite running the government of Israel for 400 years was kicking in the door of the people and compelling them at sword point to pay their tithing. Their tithings and their free will offerings were free will offerings because it was a true and pure republic under the authority of God. They say a theocracy. We don't want a theocracy. The theocracy of Israel could not suppress or oppress the people in their midst. You didn't have to join their church. You didn't have to join their system of Corbin. You didn't even have to pay into it if you did join it. It was a system based on faith, hope, and charity and free will offerings and individual responsibility. It was a government from the bottom up of the people, for the people, and by the people. And it was ruled by God, so it was a theocracy, in the hearts of every individual who could not oppress their neighbor. What happens in that system is that if you really are doing it, that those who don't want to live by virtue don't thrive. And those who do, do thrive. But those of you who want to live by virtue have been seduced into making covenants. So now you have to remain friends with the unrighteous mammon. Unless you want to become a true minister of Christ. And then you can prepare a table so that when the unrighteous mammon fails, those who have been friends in the system will have a more righteous habitation. If you're in the system, don't cheat. Don't lie. Make your yeses yes in the daytime, but at night, seek the kingdom of God. Now, it's your work day. You're in a job. You got to do that job. You work for an employer. You do it the way he says. And you're all employed by the federal government, so they say this is the way you do it, so you do it that way. But start setting the table of the Lord so that you have someplace else to go when the table of the unrighteous fails. You should have been doing this for the last 20, 30, 40, 50 years. You haven't been, because you've been listening to ministers who are preaching damnable heresies that say it's okay to covet your neighbor's goods, even though you could do a better job by following the ways of Christ. You are all registered people. Now, some of you want to get unregistered. I understand that. You will not be free till you set your neighbors free. And a lot of you already don't want to take those benefits. You're young, you're strong. But what about the families? What about the elderly? Are you ready to take on all the elderly that want to go this way? You cannot be free. You will not be free until you care about your neighbor as much as yourself. And the only way to show me that you care about your neighbor is to gather together. To organize yourself from the bottom up in tens, hundreds, and thousands. I don't believe you care about your neighbor if you're not doing that. And I'm saying that to help you with your unbelief. Because if you really believed in what Jesus said, you would be doing that. Because that's what he said to do. Gather in his name. Do not forsake the gathering together. Love your neighbor. Physically love your neighbor. Don't just hug them. I see people hug all the time and then hire people to force their neighbor to contribute to their welfare at the point of a gun. So where's the love in that? Show me real love. Show me real love. Start doing what Christ said. Stop being idiots. Start learning what it means to be idiotas, non-participators. And the way to do that is start becoming participators in the ways of Christ. The modern Christian is idiotus. He is not a participator in the kingdom of God. He's told to sit and wait for the kingdom of God to come. Jesus done it all. You don't have to do anything. Just come to church, tithe to me so I, you know, get lots of money and drive a nice car and all this stuff. I don't tell you you have to tithe to me. You have to seek the Holy Spirit. He'll tell you who to tithe to. I'm not telling you what to do other than seek the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, and the righteousness of God. And stop seeking the unrighteousness of the world. And that's going to take a lot of work. It's going to take a lot of dedication. And you have to decide what you're going to do in seeking that kingdom of God. Now, a lot of people don't know that there's building codes in the Bible. There's a building code about, balconies, having a railing around them, about digging pits, and etc. You have to not create a hazardous situation. That's what Moses is trying to impart with his codes. He's explaining the Ten Commandments with his codes, his statutes of Moses. He's not trying to create rules and regulations that, oh, if I do this, I step on B, and then I step on C, and then I step on D, then I get into the kingdom of heaven. He's trying to give you a picture of the kingdom of God. And once you start understanding that, and then maybe learn a little Hebrew and read them again, you'll realize what he's really talking about. He didn't want to create codes that if you don't put a balcony according to his specs on your roof, he can come in and fine you. He can actually tax you more because you didn't put in the right kind of balcony. He puts in those rules so that you don't create a hazard, so that if you, you know, you put a real flimsy little balcony up there and, or no balcony, rail at all, and somebody, you invite people up and they get hurt, that you can be held responsible for negligence, because he's already explained that it's reasonable to put a stout little railing around a balcony because you don't want to invite people into a hazardous situation. Now, if we take that over to that precept, over to what we were talking about, the system of Corbin, the system of Social Security, whereby you force your neighbor to contribute to your welfare, we realize that that's creating a hazardous situation, because it will make the word of God to none effect. It will divide and weaken your society and bring them into bondage, which is exactly what's happened. And there's little pet things, like people say, well, you know, I live in a free country. Well, no, you don't. If the bondage of Egypt was that you had to pay 20% of everything you earned to the government, and you were never to return to the bondage of Egypt again, then how come you're paying 20, 30, 40, 50% to the government? Why, you know, like somebody sent the little video on, you know, parents' rights, how the government can say what you can do with your kids, what you can teach your kids, what you have to teach your kids, what they can teach your kids. Why is that happening? That's because you've gone and said to the government, be my father, take care of me, provide for me, be my benefactor. Even though the government doesn't give you its money, it gives you your neighbor's money. So there's a million ways in which all these things are pointing to different little elements of not being in the kingdom. If you have a need in your congregation, do those that have extra share with that person, or does your pastor give them the phone number to the welfare people in the governments of the world that are going to provide him nothing but what they take away from your other neighbors? You know, to me it's so obvious, but these people, they think, oh, I got it already. Well, if they continue in that, if, you know, maybe when you catch somebody complaining about this thing or that thing, well, and somebody told me the other day, somebody who works for the government actually said that if somebody doesn't vote, they don't have a right to complain. That's a common little thing. Actually, it's the other way around. If you do vote, you don't have a right to complain, because you've gone up to a common purse of rights and you say, I'm going to vote with you guys, and the guys who have the most vote will win and get to decide how many of my rights I get to keep. It's like the quarter ante, penny ante, nickel ante game they used to play in the army. Everybody, you know, would throw out their nickel on the bunk, or their dollar, or whatever it was. Inflation is probably more now. Show you how old I am. I used to be a nickels and quarters when I was doing it. I only did it once. And I saw the guy scooping. I actually saw my quarter going into his hands. And I thought, boy, I'm never going to do that again. You can't throw your quarter down there on that bunk bed and bet with all those other guys unless you covet all those other guys' quarter. You're not throwing your quarter down for any other reason than you want their quarter, and you can't get a chance to get their quarter unless you throw that quarter down. So that act is evidence that you're praying to get their quarter. You're coveting your neighbor's goods. You want to win their quarter. If you were a Christian, you would want them have what they need. People want me to buy a lottery ticket. It's for a good cause, so that, you know, for a buck I can get a chance of winning this raffle kind of deal, and it goes to help blind kids or whatever. I said, no, here's a buck, go help blind kids. It's creating the wrong atmosphere. And so I was making references to when they were in bondage in Egypt, and Moses was trying to teach the people how to be a free government and they were going to have to go through these plagues and earthquakes and all these things, which is a pattern we're going to see again. It's a pattern of the early church. It's a pattern of even in the days of Abraham, because Abraham spent about 70 years before those many souls came out with him, and there's a whole history of that most of the people are ignorant of. But they were in the bondage of Egypt. They had to pay into the government. That government provided them with all their benefits, their leeks and onions, their social welfare. They had to now still pay their tally of bricks, but glean in the field at night for their straw. These are metaphors in the language. Charity is supposedly taking something you have and giving to others. And so therefore we say, well, that guy was very charitable. We think of social welfare systems as charity. But the reality is, in the time of affluence, we're not strengthening the poor, we're weakening the poor. We're getting them to the point where they sit there and they expect to be taken care of. And where, how do you tell the difference? And the Bible tells us, by their fruits. What are we producing in society? What kind of society are we producing? And how does it come out that way? We have a society today where people can be raped in the streets and nobody does anything. People shut their doors. They hide away. We can see rights of the people being taken away. You know, when you were arrested and put in prison in the old days, you got to wear the same clothes. You actually kept your money in your pocket. They didn't have a right to your money. They're just arresting you. They didn't take your shoelaces away from you. They didn't do any of that stuff. They just simply imprisoned you. And then you had certain rights even then. But today, all your rights are taken away from you, and then they give you back what they want. But what we've done is we've created a society in which there's no hue and cry. People are raped in the courts. People are raped in the economy with things like inflation, and nobody does anything about it. Nobody in the Christian churches, almost, except for a few rare exceptions, are tending to anything that would fit the category of the weightier matters as described by Jesus Christ, and which is law, judgment, mercy, and faith. They say that doesn't have anything just believe in Jesus. We don't have to worry about law, judgment, mercy, and faith. We just believe in Jesus. If you believe in Jesus, you will be tending to law, judgment, mercy, and faith, because he said those were the weightier matters, and that's what you should be attending to. You won't have a system of social welfare based on forcing your neighbor to contribute. And so we see the fruits of their charity is not fruits at all. Sweet in the mouth, sour in the belly. These are, again, metaphors that we see repeated over and over again. So on an individual basis, you really don't know, should I do this for this person? Should I do that for that person? You have to go by the Holy Spirit. And then you say, well, how do I know it's the Holy Spirit? Well, that's what you have your life for, is to learn the difference between the Holy Spirit and the unholy spirits that are all around you all the time, whispering in your ear and in your heart to do it this way or to do it that way or whatever. And the only way to know is you know them by their fruits. They know us by our love for one another. Do you see Christians in the church proclaiming love with their mouth or with their deeds? If they've delivered the whole nation back into the bondage of Egypt, then they don't really love each other. And that's what they've done. They've delivered the entire world back into the bondage of Egypt. And if you don't want to be a part of that system, they will throw you in jail. They will persecute you. They will send SWAT teams to your door and arrest you. Because they don't want to set you free. And that's why I tell people, you can't, there is absolutely no reason to get rid of your social security number and try to come out of the system, come out of Babylon, whatever they think is coming out of the Babylon, until you want to set your neighbor free. And the only way to do that is to come together in faith, hope, and charity, and bind yourselves with virtue and honor.